In case of multicollinearity, Verrilli actually considered two cases. The third case appears to you now. It is a numerical example, as you can see. The interesting thing in this is if you run a regression y on x1 alone, you will get an explained variation which is very, very close to the total variation. R square is 0.398985, and it is significant, of course. In case if you run a regression y hat on x2, you will get an explained variation which is very, very close to the explained variation previously obtained in case if you regress y on x1 alone. The interesting thing in this case is that R square, the coefficient of differentiation yx2, is also very, very near to R square, the multiple regression coefficient of y with x1 obtained for x1 and x2. Multiple regression and multiple coefficient determination which is very high, and at the same time insignificant coefficient x1 and x2. This means that we are considering a very severe multicollinearity. This means that equation 3 does not make any sense. It is of no scientific value. Consider the Venn diagram appearing now to you. You will find that the joint determination of x1 and x2, which you cannot split, that is, be broken in two parts, would be 99.98%, which is certainly very close to 100%. The partial coefficient determination of y, x1, keeping x2 constant is 0.01014%, which is nearly nothing. The same goes for the partial coefficient with determination yx2 keeping x1 constant. You will get it to be equal to 0.00286%. Also, this is very insignificant. So, as I said before, now we can easily follow them. This test is designed to determine which variables are multicollinear. Let us have the following function. Y is a function of x1, x2, x3, x4. It is a linear function. The idea is to run the following regressions, and for each you calculate the coefficient of determination. X1 is a function of x2, x3, x4, and calculate the relevant multiple regression, coefficient of determination. Do the same thing for x2, function of x1, x3, and x4. X3, function of x1, x2, x3, and x4. X1, x2, and x4. And x4, function of x1, x2, and x3. Calculate for each the multiple coefficient of differentiation. You calculate the F value, as you can see, that it's a form, it's a rule appears to you. N here denotes the sample size, and the K denotes the number of variables. HO states that the row, the multiple coefficient determination in the population is zero. That is, it does not exist. H1, the alternative hypothesis, states that the rho square, the multiple the multiple different the determination coefficient is not equal to zero. For you, you are not responsible for that in the exam. I'm not going to ask you about anything written in this introduction. The thing is page 11. Having calculated the partial correlation coefficient between, say, x1, x2, keeping the effects of other x's constants, the t value is given as follows. T is equal to R x1, x2, keeping x3, x4, and other x's up to xk, times the square root of n minus k, divided by the root of 1 minus r square x1 x2 keeping x3 x4 up to xk constant. HO states that rho in the population is 0. H1 states that it is not equal to 0. The observed t value is compared with the tabulated t value with dfn minus k at the chosen level of significance, say 0.05. If the observed t value is greater than the tabulated, we reject HO in favor of H1. That is, x1 and x2 are significant. That is, x1 and x2 are responsible for the multiplicity and the function. If the observed t value is less than that tabulated, that is, t tabulated, then there partial correlation is not significantly, is not statistically significant. That is, x1 and x2 are not the cause of multicollinearity. We move to autocorrelation and the Darwin-Watson D statistic. An important assumption of the ordinary least squares is that the successive values of the random variable mu are independent, that is, the value of which U assumes in any one period is independent from the value which is assumed in any previous period. This assumption implies that the covariance of Ui and Uj is equal to zero. If this assumption is not satisfied, that is, if the value of U in any particular period is correlated with its own preceding value or values, we say that there is autocorrelation or serial correlation with the random variable. The Darwin-Watson statistic is used for a certain test. It suggests that the Darwin and Watson have suggested that a test which is applicable to random samples. The test is appropriate only for the first order autoregressive scheme. The test may be outlined as follows. HO rho is equal to zero, that is, U's are not autocorrelated. H1 rho is not equal to zero, that is, U's are serially dependent. To test the null hypothesis the null hypothesis, we compute D statistics, it appears to you. The table given, it illustrates how to consider the E's. ET, ET minus 1, ET minus ET minus 1, ET minus ET minus 1 all squared, ET squared. We're interested in the summation of the fifth column, that summation E2 minus ET minus 1 all squared, and the last column, summation, last column, summation of E squared T. You can follow the steps given in page 14, and at the end you'll discover that D is approximately equal to 2 times 1 minus rho hat, the estimated rho. For this expression, the values of D lie between 0 and 4, as it appears from firstly, secondly, and thirdly. the chart given at the end of page 15 gives you the full picture. D, the value of D is runs from 0 to 4, and the midpoint 2. We have here DL and DU, that is D lower and D upper. If the calculated D falls between 0 and DL, we say there is positive autocorrelation. If it falls between DL and DU, we say the test is inconclusive. You can say there is or there isn't a positive autocorrelation. Certainly, if the calculated D is greater than DU, you say there is no positive autocorrelation. But if the DU falls between 4 minus DU, then the test is inconclusive. If it falls between 4 minus DL and 4, you say there is a negative autocorrelation. And page 16, you can see that there are three possibilities to determine whether or not there is a positive autocorrelation. Also, for testing for negative autocorrelation, there are three cases. First one shows that there is no positive autocorrelation or negative autocorrelation. Number two, there is negative autocorrelation if D falls between 4 minus DL and 4. Number three, if D falls between 4 minus DU and 4 minus DL, then the test is inconclusive. Page 17 is a copy of the significance of the DL DU for K, the number of variables K1, K2, K3, K4, K5, and N starts from 15 to 100. Simply because if N is smaller than 15, you can't rely on the test. Page 18, the assumption of homostaticity. Homo means equal, and statistic means variance. This assumption implies that the variance of each ui is constant, the same, that is, for all values of the exponent variable, if it is not satisfied in any particular case, we say that ui are heterostatistic, which means that it's not homostatistic. There is a very familiar test which is called Kordfeld and Condit test. The observations must be at least twice as many as the parameters to be estimated. HO states that U's are homostatistic. H1 states that U's are heterostatistic with increasing variance, which is a familiar case in case of econometrics. There are three steps to U, and you can easily understand them. I have written this in full details. The F star, the F calculated assembly is equal to summation E2 squared divided by summation E1 squared. And this F has an F test, an F distribution mean, with certain degrees of freedom for numerator and the denominator, which are both equal to each other. If the two variances are the same, that is, if the U's are homostatistic, the value of F star will tend to be equal to 1. The calculated F is compared with the tabulated value of F with the same degrees of freedom for numerator and denominator at the chosen level of significance. If F star is greater than F, we accept that there is a heterostatisticity. We reject HO. If f star is less than f, we do not reject the null hypothesis that the use are homoscedastic. Now we move to the identification problem. There are certain definitions given in page 21, and I believe you can easily follow them from the estimated reduced four coefficients. If this can be done, we say that the particular equation is identified, mumayyaza. If this cannot be done, then we say that the equation under consideration is unidentified or underidentified, أقل من مميزة أو غير مميزة. System of simultaneous equation is said to be identified if and only if, إذا وإذا فقط, each and every equation is in the system is identified. There are two conditions for identification. The first condition is the order condition for identification. It states that the number of variables in the model, whether they are exogenous or endogenous, that is exogenous and endogenous together, minus the number of variables in the equation includes exogenous and endogenous variables, that is to be identified, the equation to be identified, should be either greater than or equal to the number of equations in the system minus one. There are two possibilities here. In case k minus m is equal to g minus one, the system of simultaneous equation is said to be exactly identified, mumayyaz tamama. In this case, the method of estimation is the indirect least squares, ILS. Number double is, in case of k minus m is greater than g minus 1, the system of simultaneous equation is said to be over-identified, أكثر من مميز. In this case, the method of estimation is the maximum likelihood, MLM, or two-stage least squares. Number three is, in case of k minus m is less than g minus 1, the system of simultaneous equation is said to be under-identified. In this case, the system cannot be estimated by any acrometric method. You can follow easily the example given for an agricultural commodity, say rice. D, the demand. S is supply. W is water. Y is income. P is unit price. As you can see at the end of page 23, k minus m is exactly g minus 1, that's 2 is the 2, exactly identified, ILS. Page 24, the rank condition for identification. In a system of g simultaneous equations, a particular equation is said to be set to satisfy the rank condition if it is possible to construct at least one non-zero determinant of rank g minus 1 from the coefficients of the variables excluded from that equation but included in the other equations in the model of simultaneous equations. This is quite clear in the example given. Page 24 and 25. Now, there are certain questions here for you. I must remind you that these questions are concerned with the present part. But of course, you are responsible about the previous lectures from the first lecture you have. For the PhD qualifying exam, PhD qualifying exam, let us start with quick legs.